Probably might sound like hyperbole to say that Streets of Rage 4 will change the face of gaming, but it's certainly a sign of things shifting within Sega. Among the many jewels of the classic era of Sega's heyday, Streets of Rage is one series that doesn't get a lot of love anymore. Once upon a time, this series was Sega's answer to Final Fight, a colourful, bombastic beat-em-up that sees players punch and kick their way through densely packed city streets. But, as Sega's star waned at the end of the 16-bit era, Streets of Rage was one of many game franchises to be cut short. Following Streets of Rage 3 in 1994, there has never been a successful revival of this once-beloved series. Until now. Suddenly, everything has changed. Sega has partnered with indie studio Lizard Cube to create an authentic sequel to the classic series. This game, instead of using pixely sprite art, instead features glorious 2D animation that really brings the characters to life. The bold change in art style remains faithful to the original games while updating them for the technology of the modern era, and it looks good. If the name Lizard Cube rings a bell, this is because this isn't the first time the studio has reimagined a classic Sega title with beautiful modern 2D animation. The team's first game, Wonder Boy: The Dragon's Trap, takes a Master System game of the same name and gives it a dramatic overhaul, turning an aging classic into a modern masterpiece. If you're interested in learning more about that game's development, we did a video on the team at Lizard Cube and how they got started. It's in the description below. Streets of Rage 4, then, continues a trend that Sega seems to have almost accidentally stumbled upon. Lizard Cube remade The Dragon's Trap, and shortly after, Christian Whitehead and a bunch of other indie game enthusiasts created Sonic Mania. Now we're approaching yet another similar game, again from Lizard Cube. So is this Sega's new business strategy? Has the company decided to deal with its classic, if somewhat dusty, games by letting fans rework them into something modern? There are certainly worse things that the company could do. This kind of game remake or fan sequel building allows for greater creativity and originality than is possible when Sega's in-house team attempts to build something nostalgic. Plus, the games cost Sega very little to make. Sonic Mania was funded by Sega, but Lizard Cube did most of the original work on The Dragon's Trap as a hobby project, without even getting official permission for a commercial launch until the title was nearing completion. Meanwhile, the fans benefit tremendously. Sega's beloved games can be resurrected by the people who care about them the most. Here's hoping that this trend continues. There's already a fan project in the works that rebuilds an ancient Alex Kidd game with modern technology. The democratizing of Sega's archive could well help to kick off a wave of newfound appreciation for older games that otherwise don't get their due. Sega could even create a specific, organized brand for all these fan works. If they expand their scope, and give more up-and-coming developers the chance to play with their toys, there could be a whole series of such titles, all under a unifying banner. This could help fans easily identify a new remake or sequel that comes from an inventive group of upstarts. Of course, Sega will have to be very careful. If this is the beginning of a new trend, and the company gives their seal of approval to additional fan projects and indie remakes or sequels, they'll have to be very selective about which studios they trust with their games. Lizard Cube and the Sonic Mania team are passionate, but they're also talented and experienced. Many of the team members involved with these projects have years of experience working in the indie gaming industry. It would only take one or two poorly received, officially licensed indie projects before the reputation of this new series of games could be undermined. Sega has traditionally been somewhat cavalier with their branding, a lot more so than their rivals Nintendo. This means that Sega will often allow weird fan projects to become official releases, as with The Dragon's Trap. But it also gives us games like Sonic, the Dark Brotherhood. If BioWare couldn't be trusted to make a decent Sega title, then the company will need to be very, very selective about which unproven indie studios they allow to take the reins. All of this aside, the idea of new games from fans, playing with official Sega licenses, is fantastic. With any luck, Streets of Rage 4 is just the beginning. It's significant that this is a sequel, rather than a straight remake. Lizard Cube is being trusted with a lot of freedom this time around, and the result is likely going to be something special. These kinds of projects merge the respectability and polish of official Sega releases with the passion and enthusiasm of fan game developers. This match made in heaven ensures that creativity and originality abound, even in an existing franchise that's already been around for nearly 3 decades. When big companies allow little teams of passionate creators to play with their toys, everybody wins. That's why Streets of Rage 4 is more than just a new installment in a classic franchise. It's also an indicator of just how much originality and flavour can be introduced to the games industry, if only big companies are willing to take a chance on the little guy.